Right. Thank you very much. It's a privilege, the last speaker. So I think when Professor Sudhakshini Damji talked about the patient-centered care, it sort of led in to what this observational data that we undertook at Kenyatta National Hospital, which is our local setup, was meant to really demonstrate that there are certain minimal symptoms that our patients may experience that will completely ruin or, you know, their quality of life, even though the values that you are monitoring may be accurate. So I'm going to talk about one of the symptoms that's very common in hemodialysis patients, pruritus, or the sensation to, or the desire to itch. And we saw it amongst our dialysis patients locally in Kenyatta National Hospital. It's sort of some observational data. We really wanted to know what is going on. So, like, you know, it is just a sensation that's usually unpleasant on the skin, and it could provoke people to want to scratch, and it can be sometimes embarrassing because it may not give you peace of mind or even peace to do things that you want to do every day. So it's an important symptom of CKD, and probably, in fact, in patients who are dialyzing. The prevalence is quite varied, depending on how you're looking at it. Maybe anywhere between 40 to 84%, and that is sort of any sort of pruritus, whether it is mild, whether it is, you know, severe. And patients have been seen to be affected significantly by the occurrence of this, so that if you have severe pruritus, you are likely to be disturbed in your sleep. You are likely to feel drained and probably underperforming your duty. You're likely to even actually have depression. And most importantly, it reduces your quality of life. And in fact, it's been associated with a 17% higher risk of all-cause mortality. So it's an important thing, and even though it is quite prevalent then, and we know the consequences, like I've said, it still remains very poorly characterized and understood, really, for that matter. And we don't even have our own local data to see whether it is actually present amongst our patients, so we just probably ignoring to elicit it, or ask, not necessarily elicit, but ask whether it occurs. So majority of these patients will suffer. They may not be on any symptom ameliorating treatment for hemodialysis-associated pruritus. And most likely they'll continue to have poor quality of life, even though you look at their calciums, their hemoglobin, their KT over V, and realize that probably you're achieving your target, but perhaps you are not, if you're not dealing with other issues like pruritus that reduce or make the patient uncomfortable and reduce their overall achievement or better quality of life. So therefore, what is the question? Is it a problem, and how big is it in our setup? Meaning, does it even really exist here? And if it is existent in our patients, how serious is it? How does it interfere with our patients? That was really what we sought to see or to understand amongst our cohort in Kenyatta National Hospital. And how does hemodialysis-associated pruritus and pruritus disabilities cause correlate or relate with the clinical and, in fact, laboratory characteristics in these patients? Is there a way we can look at certain things and say it predicts? Or it tells us that the patient is likely to experience worse pruritus if we look at their clinical characteristics or their laboratory characteristics. That is the question we wanted to ask ourselves. So it was actually these patients attending hemodialysis sessions at Kenyatta National Hospital, particularly those with end-stage renal disease, meaning they were chronic hemodialysis, and those that had been dependent on hemodialysis for a period exceeding 1 month after an episode of acute kidney injury, meaning that probably they were in the failure sort of stage of renal dysfunction. And the reason for that is that we didn't really consider so much an acute kidney injury setup per se. That was our criteria for including them. So it was a survey, sort of a cross-sectional survey. We just sought to see all patients at that time. And since the cohort of these of Kenyatta dialyzing cohort was a limited number, or a small number for that matter, it was about 100 patients. We just took all the patients and surveyed them. And if you had any primary dermatological disease and related to renal failure, we use that as a way of excluding you from including you from the study, for that matter, from this observational data that we are reporting. And actually, there was just one patient who had a lupus, systemic lupus nephritis, systemic lupus erythematosus that still had active skin lesions, which we thought would not allow us to assess what we needed to assess. Now, there are many scales that people have used to sort of bring objectivity into even defining what pruritus is. And there are many scales, including just the linear scale where someone says, I have pruritus, how severe is it in a scale of, let's say, 1 to 5, and they tell you it is 3 out of 5, and so forth. But there is one particular scale that is called 5B pruritus scale. This is a scale that has been proposed recently as probably more comprehensive in the sense that it looks at different dimensions of pruritus. And the first D is actually duration, for how long have you had it? The second D is the degree, how intensive, or what is the intensity of it? The third D is direction, meaning is it improving? Is it not changing? Is it getting better? Is it getting worse? And the fourth D is disability. And in the fourth D, disability, like you can see here, we were looking at four things, actually. How does it impair your sleep? How does it impair your leisure or social activities? How does it impair your housework coherence, or even actually work or attendance to school? And we could score depending on the descriptors put above each disability domain. And the one that had a biggest score is what we consider. For instance, if we scored you on all these four, and let's say housework errands was the one that gave us a biggest score, let's say of 5, we took it and sort of blind these others. And the fifth D was the distribution, meaning in which part of the body are we seeing it really? And we could score the number of parts, and depending on the number, we could give a weight. And the weight ranked between 1 and 5, just like these others, to enable us score you finally out of 25, because you realize if every score ends at 5, so you can have a minimum of 5 and a maximum of 25 units or scores for these pruritus. Why is this important? Because it is easy to say I have pruritus without knowing what's the implication of it as an individual, as a person. So that's why it is a multi-directional, faceted sort of scale. And that is what we used. That sort of just explain how we were using that scale, but at least you have an idea of what we were using to objectively say you have pruritus. And you needed to have a score of at least 5 and above for us to accept you as having pruritus, meaning that, if I can go back, meaning that if you score less than 6 hours, not present, completely resolved, or never affects sleep, or probably it doesn't, it affects only maybe chest, we excluded you. We needed you to score 5 and above. So if you have 4 and 3 and 2 and 1, we considered you not having pruritus. Because again, we needed to do that because that is how the scale is used according to the people who designed it. And it was meant to make sure you capture the people who have pruritus and which lead to some sort of disturbance in their life, either in any of these domains. Fine. So we were looking at various variables, and we were just basically looking at the biodata, what led to the to your chronic kidney disease, was it hypertension, was it glomerulonephritis, was it diabetes, what are the other associated symptoms that you have, like xerosis, neuropathy, duration since the start of dialysis, otherwise called dialysis vintage, a number of dialysis hours per week, hemoglobin, mean corpuscular volume, calcium, phosphate, creatinine, urea, ferritin, C-reactive protein, intact parathyroid hormone. Later on, you'll notice that I didn't get really into these last three variables down here, because it was a cross-sectional survey and most of the patients didn't have these values at the moment we were doing this survey, but almost all are the rest of the things, obviously. And the dependent variables that we were trying to assess was actually the presence of pruritus and the pruritus disability score. So the score was based on the 5D scale that we designed, and basically it meant that if you have certain number of scores, we weighted it and assigned you a score of something that ranges between 5 and 25. Right, okay, fine. So going to the results, therefore, so the patient, the cohort was small. It's not quite a number of patients at that time that we surveyed. And actually, these were all the patients at that time that needed to be dialyzed for a chronic term basis, and maybe a few were needed to be dialyzed for 1 month beyond the acquisition of acute kidney injury. There were like 109 patients, and with an average age of 46 years. And actually, it was distributed almost equally. Just 50% were female and around 51% were male. 51-49, let's say so. So 51 were male. And you can see most, according to the data that we saw at that point in time, seem to have a diagnosis of chronic glomerulonephritis as their main cause of end-stage renal disease. And we had a criteria for defining whether someone had glomerulonephritis other than just a biopsy, because remember, most of our patients don't get to have biopsy before we define the actual pathology. If you happen to read this paper, you will know the criteria that you are using. And diabetes came in second, around 25%, contributing to end stage, followed by hypertension, the usual three suspects. And then obstructive neuropathies was about 8.3%. And the rest, you know, AKI that did not resolve and ended up and requiring dialysis for a long time, beyond 3 months to qualify as CKD, is 3.7% basically. So really, I didn't put everything in terms of these variables that I mentioned, but I selected the clinical here that I just want to see. And maybe, you know, you can realize that most of our patients, majority actually, almost, you know, 22, 20, almost 45% seem to have skin dryness, cirrhosis as the biggest associated clinical variables that was observed. About 22% at a urine output, 23% that was less than 200. And that's important. We wanted to look at it particularly because we wanted to later on correlate as to whether it contributes to pruritus or pruritus disability scores. Neuropathy, we observed it in about 47% of our patients, almost half. And hemodialysis vintage, or the median, was around 8 months. Most of our patients have been dialyzing for 8 months. It was a skewed sort of curve. There are those that would have been dialyzing for many years, but majority seem to just been falling within a median of 8 months, meaning that most of our patients probably are dialyzed for a shorter time. Like we know, dialysis is a disease that, or is an intervention that ultimately leads to some sort of mortality. So no wonder the the sort of short vintage. And the weekly hours more than 8, meaning actually more than 2 sessions, and that would be 3 sessions for that matter, was only observed in 5 of our patients, meaning majority, almost all, dialyzed twice a week. So you look at the outcome variables. For pruritus, we observed it in 37 patients out of 109. That is approximately 34%. And that actually forms the prevalence of pruritus among is that cohort that you are seeing. And the pruritus disability score, we had to wait to do some weighting. Once you get a score of 5 to 25, there is a measure that would allow you to weigh so that if your score is like, for instance, 5 to 10, weigh, we give you a mark. It is from, let's say, 10 to 15, we give you a mark. It is from 10 to 20, we give you a mark, and so forth. And finally, we use those as disability scores, and we realize that majority of our patients had a disability score in the, so the range, final range was between 1 and 5. So majority of our patients actually had a disability score that was on average, can I say, but again, the median is 2, meaning that it wasn't severe pruritus, because the severity is what defines the disability score. And majority actually had mild pruritus, if we can speak. So in our disability score, anything more than 3 is what was considered to be severe pruritus. Remember, the range is 1 to 5 in terms of disability score, not the pruritus score. So those who had disability score of more than 3/5, meaning 4 and 5, were only 7. And that is 7 out of 37, meaning it's approximately 18.9%. And those are the patients that actually suffered most from the, in terms of impairment in quality of life from the pruritus. Remember, if you go back, or if you remember the scale that we displayed, it is in the fourth domain where we are assessing the way it affects your sleep, your work, your leisure, your errands, and so forth. It's what we use to sort of become a surrogate for the quality of life. We didn't actually use the actual quality of life scales that are used to assess many other clinical situations. But the 5D multidirectional pruritus score provides the domain, the fourth domain, in which it can help you assess the quality of life in a near objective manner as a result of pruritus. So I think the most important thing I want to mention about, so these are the sort of the clinical characteristics of these patients of the cohort that we are looking at. So I think this may not make a lot of sense except for some parameters like hypoalbuminemia, where approximately 40 patients of the total cohort of 107, forming approximately 37%, had hypoalbuminemia. We cannot define this as to mean much. It could be malnutrition, it could be inflammatory processes that are going on in these patients, or it could be just a marker of poor dialysis that is a concern. Whether it is either of those things, quite a number of patients, approximately 37%, had hypoalbuminemia. And I think another parameter that I want to bring to your attention is anemia. Of the 107 patients that we saw, realize that 99, forming a 91% of them actually had anemia. That's not a surprise. I mean, most of the patients with undergoing chronic hemodialysis would have anemia, and anemia we defined in the usual way. From males less than 13 and female less than 12. And we realize that's quite prevalent among this cohort. And actually, the median hemoglobin in this cohort was 9.3. Perhaps not so bad, but we are off the target still, because remember the KDIGO, like we had yesterday and like we know, would run somewhere around 11.5. perhaps even sometimes going to 12. But still have a bit of some work to surmount that. That was the median. And the range was, the interquartile range was somewhere between 7.8 to 10.5. So creatinine is still quite an issue. I don't know how this would compare to other units across the country. What's your prevalence rate for anemia? What is your prevalence rate for hypoalbuminemia? So forth. Because those are the markers that Dr. Njogu talked about earlier on. But was there an association between demographic and clinical characteristics of these patients and pruritus status? Of importance, what I've highlighted, it seems that if you have diabetes mellitus as the cause of your end-stage renal dysfunction or renal failure for that matter, you are likely not to have pruritus as opposed to if you have other reasons contributing to it. We don't know why. It appears like perhaps diabetes, and we hypothesize, we don't know, of course, even the literature is not available to justify our hypothesis. Maybe something that can just, prod us a bit to look into this issue. It appears that pruritus, diabetes mellitus may mask either out of the fact that you have other neuropathies or poor sensations, or some sort of microvascular disease affecting the nerves, or actual dysfunction of the nervous system, or some sort of complications of diabetes. Maybe it prevents you from having adequate sensation to perceive pruritus. That's just a thought, but it's something that's caught our eye. And another thing I want to bring to your attention is that the patient who had cutaneous cirrhosis, the dryness of the skin, and that was objectively just picked up from clinical examination when we were collecting the data. Majority of them tended to have pruritus, that is approximately 75%, meaning there was a big component of cirrhosis contributing to people having pruritus. For the other clinical and perhaps some other demographic characteristics, we didn't see a very clear association. We didn't really realize whether there was an association. Again, we are limited because our data was a very small cohort, 109, very few patients. But absence of diabetes or diabetes tended to be associated with absence of pruritus, and cirrhosis, if it was present, tended to be associated with presence of pruritus, perception of pruritus amongst our patients. How about the laboratory characteristics? So we didn't see any association amongst the laboratory characteristics that we looked. And like I said, we were looking at hemoglobin, MCV, albumin levels, calcium, phosphate, interparathyroid hormone. I excluded interparathyroid hormone and ferritin levels and T-SATs because the numbers of the patients who avail these sort of variables were very few. And again, it reflects on our inability to run all the tests that we would have loved to do in patients on hemodialysis, particularly in this particular cohort. I know it may be different elsewhere, but just reporting. So for the laboratory characteristics that we looked, I think by and large, we're talking about hematological characteristics, hemoglobin, MCV, and then biochemical characteristics, particularly calcium, phosphates, urea, creatinine, and actually those ones we didn't seem to contribute at all to the occurrence of pruritus in these patients. However, we later on see that there tended to be some signal towards the association between absence of anemia and pruritus, which was a bit surprising to me. I'll talk about that a little later. But was there an association between demographic and clinical characteristics with pruritus disability score? Remember, if you had a pruritus disability score of 3 and less, we considered you as having a low score that did not translate to significant impairment in life, as opposed to if you had more than three, meaning if you had four and five. So in the disability score range of one to five, four and five defined an individual who was going to bear the brunt of the pruritus in the sense of having a lower quality of life. According to the five-day scale.
Peter, sorry to interrupt you, but please, time is a factor. We are taking too long. So just give us the highlights in the conclusion.
Okay. Yeah. So I think so urine output less than 200 was it really contributed towards disability scores. And I think this is the second last line. So it was prevalent at approximately 34%, and cirrhosis and absence of diabetes positively correlated with the occurrence of pruritus. The laboratory characteristics had no correlation with the occurrence of pruritus. And among the participants that had pruritus, approximately 18% had higher disability scores reflecting significant impairment in life, in quality of life. And finally, the urine output less than 200, absence of anemia were positively correlated with the increased pruritus disability scores. So I think we need to watch it and be sure to ask if it is there, because some patients will keep quiet and not tell and think it's normal. And then please look for dryness of skin and treat it, because they're emollients and that will go a long way. And then I think all practices that will preserve restored kidney function should be important to also keep on observing them in hemodialysis patients, so that we preserve urine output or the residual function. And the surrogate here was the urine output needs to be preserved when it is possible. Thank you very much. I think that is it.
There is one or two questions which I'll maybe give you a minute to answer before we move to close the conference. In your experience, Peter, one person asks, how do you manage these patients with pruritus? And someone else asks how you think these pruritus contributes to mortality.
So first of all, if we look at pathogenesis of pruritus, you will probably realize that there are some therapeutic agents that can be applied. But the most simplest is to have your patient, be on loose clothes apparently, and then preserve the skin moisture by using emollients. That's by far probably the best. Other modalities that probably may be medical could be use of gabapentin, or actually antihistamines, particularly the later generation antihistamines like desloratadine and so forth. Doxepin may work as well. And, you know, those are the simple things that one could do. But by far the most important is emollients to preserve the skin integrity, particularly the moisture. There have been other postulations, particularly using of things like convective therapies, instead of the usual hemodialysis. That is debatable, but studies may have pointed towards that. And most importantly, the definitive obviously would be transplantation in situations. So it can be a factor that makes you move fast towards considering transplanting these patients. How it contributes to mortality, it is not so clear. And remember, this was all-cause mortality. This was sort of some observational data rather than the actual trial, where probably I mean, it could be difficult to design such a trial, so I'm not very sure about that, but it's something that elicits curiosity, still reading about it and trying to understand how does it cause mortality. It's intriguing. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Peter. I think I'll let you relax now.